Hi, everybody. I'd like to start by thanking the organizers for the invitation to this really great symposium. The ancestors of archaic and modern humans split over 500,000 years ago. And since these lineages started evolving in separate paths, they have accumulated many phenotypic differences, including changes to the size of the cerebellum, the flatness of the face, our skeletal maturation rate, and many more. And today, it is generally agreed that most phenotypic differences between closely related organisms are driven by gene regulatory changes, meaning when, where, and to what extent a gene is expressed. In modern samples, we have plenty of regulatory marks that help us decipher the level of activity of each gene in the genome. Ancient samples, on the other hand, go through rapid post-mortem degradation, leaving us with only the naked and degraded DNA sequence. And if that's not challenging enough, it is also further exacerbated by our limited ability to predict the effects of regulatory variants. So despite the fact that at most gene regulation is encoded within the DNA itself, our ability to read this code is very limited. And as a result, we know very little about how genes worked in archaic humans. Luckily, there's a method that can interrogate the functional effect of thousands of genetic variants in parallel. In massively parallel reporter assays, or MPRAs, a synthesized sequence is inserted upstream of a minimal promoter. And if this sequence has a regulatory effect, it will activate the downstream gene, which we can measure by sequencing its barcoded RNA. Now, if we synthesize a construct with the archaic human version and a modern human version that differ in a single nucleotide change, we can compare the expression between them and identify regulatory variants that affect gene expression. So for each variant that separates these human lineages, we design two constructs, one for the archaic human and one for the modern human. We then infect them into four different cell types that represent key systems in human evolution, and then identify key regulatory variants that alter gene expression, and finally, attempt to link this to their possible phenotypic effects. So together with our collaborators at the Ahituv lab, we have done this for the 14,000 variants that separate modern humans from other lineages. As well as more recently, we've analyzed the 57,000 variants that segregate archaic humans from other lineages. Together, this allowed us to create a catalog of how each of the 70,000 variants that separate human lineages affects expression, for each one, whether it is neutral or functional, in which cell type it affects expression, and to what extent. Let's start by focusing on the 14,000 variants that emerged in modern human evolution and separate all modern humans today from other lineages. Here you can see the distribution of their effects in different cell types. You can see that they tend to be centered around zero, suggesting that most variants do not have a significant effect on expression, which makes sense given how close these human lineages are. But we do find 407 genetic variants where we see a significant effect on expression. Either the modern human version increases expression or decreases expression. And in fact, in some cases, a single nucleotide change is enough to double the expression of a gene. Next, we wanted to see if we can say anything phenotypic about these variants. What is their effect on traits? To do this, we used a tool called Gene Organizer, which links genes to the organs they affect based on the diseases that they are known to underlie. And then the output is a heat map showing which organs are represented more than you would expect by chance. So what do we get when you run Gene Organizer on the 14,000 variants that are unique to modern humans? We get this heat map. You can see that if we look at variants that downregulate expression here in blue, the most enriched organ is the cerebellum. And that was interesting because, in fact, morphologically, the cerebellum is known to be the most divergent region between archaic and modern humans in the brain. If we look at variants that upregulate expression here in red, you can see that the most enriched organs are organs related to the vocal tract, so the voice box, the vocal cords, and the pharynx. And this was interesting because, in fact, it wasn't the first time we saw it. We saw this pattern of enrichment in the voice box when we compared a key regulatory mark in the genome called DNA methylation between modern and archaic humans. The voice box was the most enriched organ. We saw it again when we compared gene expression between humans and chimps. Again, the voice box was the most enriched organ. And we see it here in the variants that alter modern human expression. Again, the voice box. So overall, we suggest that genes affecting the vocal tract have gone through extensive changes in human evolution. Now let's talk about the 57,000 variants that emerged in archaic human evolution. Out of these variants, there was one variant that really caught our eye. This is a substitution from a C to a T that actually has the strongest effect in both bone cells and brain cells, neuroprogenitor cells. In fact, this single nucleotide change doubles the expression, the activity of this regulatory element in Neanderthals and Denisovans. It is found within a gene called PPM1E. And when we look at this region, we see that it is extremely conserved across mammals, suggesting that it has an important function in mammals. And we also see that it is enriched for enhancer marks. These are marks that mark a regulatory element in the genome, suggesting that this region might actually regulate the expression of PPM1E. So to test it, what we did was to take embryonic stem cells from modern humans and then use CRISPR to edit this position to the neonatal version, so neonatalize these cells in that position. And then we differentiate these cells into neural progenitor cells and check whether we see any differences in expression between the edited and the unedited versions of these cells. And indeed, we see a significant difference. When we edit this position to the archaic human variant, it significantly increases the expression of PPM1E, suggesting that this C to T transition increased PPM1E expression in Neanderthals and Denisovans. And now the question is, what is the phenotypic effect of this variant? So to do this, we focused on neurons because PPM1E is known to control the structure of neurons. And specifically, we focused on a structure called mushroom spines, which are these small protrusions from neurons that form very mature, stable synapses that are very important in long-term memory. When we overexpress PPM1E, we see a significant decrease in the number of mushroom spines in these neurons. We also see a significant reduction in the number of roots in these neurons and in the length of neurites. And this together suggests that the increased PPM1E expression that emerged in archaic humans possibly altered neuronal connectivity in Neanderthals and Denisovans. So to summarize PPM1E, we see this archaic mutation that increased PPM1E enhancer activity in archaic humans. It is actually the most extreme archaic substitution in terms of its effect. It likely reduced mushroom number, root number, and neurite length in Neanderthals and Denisovans, and possibly affected connectivity and long-term memory. Another question is why? Why would a mutation arise and reduce the number of mushroom spines in these structures? It might actually reflect the less efficient negative selection that we hypothesize Neanderthals and Denisovans to have because of their smaller population size, allowing deleterious mutation to more easily reach fixation spread in the population. But in fact, it might also represent a different hypothesis, which is a trade-off. We know that fewer mushroom spines give way to more thin spines, and thin spines give more flexibility to the brain. So maybe there's a trade-off here between long-term rigidity, a reduction in long-term memory, but maybe an increase in the flexibility of the brain. So to summarize, we took the 70,000 variants that separate modern from archaic humans. We use MPRAs to map the effect of each variant on gene expression. We find around 1,200 variants that significantly altered archaic and modern gene expression. We see that they tend to affect the brain, some skeletal traits, and especially the vocal tract. And we find a specific variant within PPM1E that likely affected neuronal morphology and function. And now to the last part of the presentation. I'm going to talk about multi-step or continuous evolution, as well as convergent evolution. So let's start with a scenario where a gene experiences shared evolutionary pressures along both of these lineages. In such cases, we might expect, for example, to see an increase in the expression of the gene along both of these lineages, leading to similar high expression levels across both lineages. Now, such cases of convergent evolution are particularly hard to identify because this similar level of expression might be mistakenly interpreted as if there was no evolutionary change, or perhaps as if there was a single change in the ancestor of these lineages. But only if we can identify convergent evolution, that is the only scenario that suggests shared evolutionary pressures in this regard. So it is important to tease apart these different options. And luckily, MPRAs can be helpful in this too. We can take the 70,000 variants that separate these lineages and look for cases where different variants actually have the same effect. They converge in the same effect on the same regulatory element. And in fact, we find many such cases. For example, this regulatory element that is associated with three genes. We see that the ancestral version of this regulatory element actually was very active, but it became downregulated along both the archaic and modern human lineages, leading to very low activity of this enhancer in both lineages, but through different mechanisms. We can also look for continuous evolution, so many steps that are accumulated over time, maybe hundreds of thousands or maybe even millions of years. In such cases, we expect to see the same direction of effect along many different changes that accumulate along these lineages. But to do so, we have to go deeper in evolution and look at the ancestors of modern and archaic humans. To do so, we took the 540,000 variants that separate all human lineages from our extant living relatives, great apes. And as before, for each variant, we designed the human version and the archaic, the ancestral version. We then infect them into two different cell types, one representing the brain, neural progenitor cells, and one for the skeleton, chondrocytes, and eventually look for variants that alter gene expression. We combine this with another tool that we developed, which is human-chimp hybrids. So unlike ancient DNA, when we deal with great apes and comparing humans to chimps, we have the privilege of actually having biological material. We have cells, we have RNA, we have chromatin, we can compare the regulation between these species. But when we take a human sample and we compare it to a chimpanzee sample and we see a difference in expression, we're never certain if this is a true evolutionary difference that separates these species, or perhaps just a result of confounding factors, such as differences in their diet, environment, toxins, or maybe cell type heterogeneity between the samples, or even just batch effects. And even in the few cases where we are more certain that this might be an evolutionary difference, it is very hard to tease apart changes in expression that are driven in cis, meaning locally by a sequence change that is close to the gene, or by trans, meaning a difference that changed the cellular environment and affects the entire genome. And this is key, because if we know that the difference in expression is driven locally in cis, we know where to look for the sequence change that underlies it. And finally, because all great apes are currently endangered, most tissues from great apes are simply unavailable. To address this, what we've done was to take human cells and chimpanzee cells and fuse them together into a human-chimp hybrid cells. In this way, the human and the chimp genomes are found within the exact same environment, the most controlled biological system that you can think of. They're exposed to the exact same conditions. And this means that if within the same cell you still see a difference in expression, this can only be attributed to a true genetic evolutionary change between the species. And even more so, because they are exposed to the same trans environment, meaning the same cellular environment containing the same transcription factors that activate genes, if we still see a difference between them, this has to be attributed to a cis regulatory change, meaning a local change that drives expression difference in the human genome, but not the chimpanzee genome, or vice versa. So, in other words, we're able to kill three birds with one stone. We're able to control for non-genetic confounders and identify true evolutionary differences. We're able to separate cis from trans effects. And because these are pluripotent stem cells, we can actually differentiate them into any cell type that we would like. And the really cool thing is that we can actually synergize hybrids with MPRAs, because the hybrids give you the expression changes that are driven in cis, and the MPRAs give you the sequence changes that underlie these expression changes. And when we combine these data sets, there was one gene that caught our eye. This is a gene called SIGAT1. We saw an enhancer where two mutations emerged in humans and significantly decreased the activity of this regulatory element. We see another regulatory element with four human-specific changes, which is unique in itself. Again, additional downregulation of this gene. And SIGAT1 did not stop there. When we look at modern humans, we see a third change, and again, another decrease of SIGAT1 that emerged this time in modern humans. And this suggests recurrent mutations in the enhancers of SIGAT1 that reduced its activity in human evolution. To further test it, we took the human-chimp hybrid cells and we differentiate them into organoids, which are these organ-like structures that are very similar to organs, but just in a microenvironment. And specifically, we differentiate them into organoids that contain mesenchymal and cartilage cells to study the skeleton. And we see a consistent reduction in expression when we look at the human genome compared to the chimpanzee genome within these cells. So what does SIGAT1 do? It is actually a very important gene in regulating the extracellular matrix, which is the matrix outside of genes. And specifically, downregulation of SIGAT1 is known to create this chain reaction that in the end reduces bone formation. To further study it, we took a knockout of SIGAT1 in mice, and we looked at the phenotypes that these knockout mice show. And we see a long list of craniofacial differences in these mice. And these differences might be familiar to you because, in fact, all of them recapitulate differences that emerged in human evolution. All of them are differences between humans and chimpanzees, suggesting that the downregulation of SIGAT1 might have played a key role in shaping the human face. So altogether, I showed you these different approaches and methods to link sequence changes to regulatory changes, to phenotypic changes, in order to uncover the molecular mechanisms and selective forces that drive human evolution. And with that, I'd like to thank all of my wonderful lab members and collaborators, and thank you for listening.